Okay, cool. And I would love to play around with the looks. Like, I would love to look, like I said before, I'm gonna try to think about how to look more masculine in some pieces. I've got this damn beard now, so I'm gonna might as well use it for something. And also, like, how femme could look with that. Like, maybe I could wear some eyeliner with the beard one day. I don't know. Just kind of play with it a little bit, you know?
You don't want to go a little smoky in the eye, too?
I could do a very light
Yeah.
smoke.
You could put like a light wash of something
Yeah.
like a thin layer of black so it's not like black on your
Yeah, like I
eyes.
almost wanted just to look more like. Almost just more like kind of goth.
For those who don't know, like, you know, Naomi and I are close friends and we go and we get, you know, our, you know, manicures and pedicures and whatever else we want to get done. You know, I'd say probably once or twice a month, and it's fun to do, right? And
Yeah.
sometimes we drive over to Massachusetts, sometimes we stay here in Vermont. Really, I think at some point in time, depending on where we find to go, the whole New England area is going to become our, like, you know, spa place that we, you know, place that we find for wellness, right?
I need to come together, share a meal, shoot some shit, talk some shit,
Yes,
and
talk
like,
some
yes,
shit.
get my nails did, get my hair did, go shopping, you know
Be
what I mean?
friends.
Exactly,
Be
get some
regular.
coffee.
So my name is Steffen Gillom, and I am glad to be here today. I would describe myself as a humanitarian first, an activist, a clinician, mental health expert, a person, a friend, and a civil rights leader in the state of Vermont.
So my name's Naomi, and my pronouns are they, them, and she, her. And right now I'm living on Wabanaki Confederate lands in the homelands of the Elgin and Abenaki people in so-called Southern Vermont. And I identify as a Black, multiracial, non-binary queer femme. And I am the collaborative director of the Susu Community Farm.
Cigarette holders.
Exactly.
My specific training in marriage and family therapy is a systemic-based training, which is different than most other mental health fields that focus more on one-on-one therapy. So I'm trained to treat individuals, couples, and families, and thus, really, communities. And so those skills, that knowledge of systems, that ability to be analytical, it does directly impact my policy work. It does directly impact my activism, and it impacts who I am. For example, as president of the Windham County NAACP, I think one of the only queer presidents in the country, I have to think about the systemic impact of the way that our branch messages and or liaisons with the community.
Okay, let's see here. Yeah, I've been on media stuff, more like around movements,
Excuse me.
so environmental stuff, civil rights stuff, but never in this way, this intentionally.
It would end qualified immunity, a legal principle that gives officials immunity from certain civil lawsuits.
We got here because the current policing system lacks the basic tenets that our democracy was founded on, which is checks and balances.
Steffen Gillom is president of the Windham County branch of the Vermont NAACP. He believes long-standing flaws in U.S. law enforcement have created a culture of misbehavior unlike any other workplace.
I think to be Black and queer is to be brave because you have to walk into most rooms knowing that, or betting that, at least half the room is going to have an opinion about you that you did not construct on your own.
Yeah, man, I don't think you should remove it if we can pull off these other two looks. That way, when we go get coffee or something on the way back, we're gonna be like, whoa,
Very fancy.
Who is
what is
that?
happening? Especially in Vermont.
I know, we're the firm.
Like,
Oh
where'd
my
they come
gosh.
from? We live here.
Oh my goodness. We could just be wearing like jeans and a t-shirt and people are like, what is happening?
What is happening? We just were in the coffee shop
Oh my God.
and we just stopped on the way over here to get some quick coffee at this like little place and this lady starts telling us all about Vermont and the history of Vermont, and I'm like,
when in Vermont? Do what the Vermonters do? And I was like, I've been living here.
I'm like, I live in Brattleboro.
I make maple syrup, you weirdo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like, I give it out as gifts.
Like, I literally have a sugar shack on my farm.
Are we giving cute right now?
I think so.
Okay. Yeah, I like it.
Black men in general are erased in Vermont. Their narratives are erased in Vermont. Black women's narratives are, you know, used a lot of times as sort of like trauma tourism or trauma porn. And the voice of the black queer person is just totally not even thought of. It's not even taken into consideration. And it's literally, it shows up nowhere in the history that I know of Vermont.
I was born in Boston, grew up in the city. I'm a city person, but I always had access to like rural spaces, so I'm comfortable here. But my father, right? My father is a jazz musician from the Mississippi Delta by way of New Orleans and Chicago. So he like ran away from home when he was like 15. His family is all like pastors and farmers and sharecroppers. And formerly enslaved people, right?
Yeah, we all come from those.
It's right, but listen, stock, yeah. But he came from there, right? And then came to like New Orleans and then Chicago and then Boston. And then there's me, right? Mm-hmm. But I am the first person not born in a rural place, mm-hmm. probably in my entire paternal line, mm-hmm. right? Like going back all the way through sharecropping, mm-hmm. all the way through enslavement, mm-hmm. all the way back to West Africa or wherever, mm-hmm. right? I would be the first person actually born in my paternal lineage in a city. So I'm actually really more of a legacy farmer. As much of a city person as I was growing up, I'm actually like, my family line is not urbanized. Like it's definitely like a rural farming. And I think of myself as a legacy farmer because of that. Like at its heart, Susu is really, you know, when we were talking earlier, we were talking about like love and friendship as kind of like an act of social justice or resistance or something like that. Like I was thinking that's exactly what Susu is. And on the surface, we're a farm project and we, our purpose is to grow, you know, like culturally relevant crops for people of color in this area who may not have access to it. Like for instance, last year we grew collard greens and okra and callaloo and Hopi red amaranth and other like heirloom crops that people of color here don't have access to on a regular basis. So we have like a community supported agriculture box that we give away to people of color in Windham County. It is hard to be a person who comes from enslaved people whose like blood is literally in the soil to try to like grow. Like, think about cotton. Like cotton is now a plant that I find a spiritual ally, but so many black people, you can't talk about like cotton, growing cotton, picking cotton because a very real, very valid reasoning. It was a very violent history there. It's generational trauma.
It's generational. And mm-hmm. you, when the picture is painted, you know, the dry air, the prickliness of the cotton, you know, the roughness that your hands, you know, the calluses that your hands form, all of those things, you know, it's almost like you can smell it and you can see it. And mm-hmm. for a lot of us who go back home, you know, mm-hmm. back down to the Deep South, it does become very real and you can place yourself there.
I moved to the discomfort of doing what I did. I moved to the discomfort of contending with those histories and that trauma so that I am better equipped and better able to create space for other people to come into it, knowing that they come into it with someone who can hold it. There's so much to be mended and healed here with indigenous people and honoring their sovereignty. And so that's a huge part of it too, creating space where there is reconciliation amongst people. One of my mentors Rich with the Atui project, you know, one of the things he very simply says is that we're all here now, and we have to just figure out how to coexist and move forward so that we can create like a more sustainable, more loving, more encompassing and healthy and all the words you want to say, future for all the generations that come after us, right?
Wow, this is pretty. Okay. Let's go touch plants. All right, let me see here. Let's see here. Let me go. I'm going to start this way and then I'll find my way to y'all. There's nothing cool to touch. Have I attended therapy as a therapist? Yes. Have I done things as a therapist that the books tell me to do? I have. But to be honest with you, having people who truly understand your experiences and being able to talk to them in a nuanced but also non-judgmental way about life, mm-hmm. I think is the most powerful sense of healing that I get. I think the beauty of the queer community is that we're ultimate caregivers anyway, which is why we're known for, and we are many people's best friends and confidants, right? Even if they aren't necessarily confidants to us.
Malcolm was one of the most beautiful, one of the most gentle men I met in all my life.
There is queer expression in this body language. I think that there is a queerness, a strength, even in something as normal as a speech to a big crowd that colors him in a way. I mean, the smile. There is a certain gayness to it. And the most respectful sense of the word that gives me power. Black men aren't taught to smile. We're not taught to, you know, wade our bodies. We're not taught to snap our fingers and move our faces in ways that I believe are part of natural human expression and honestly allow us to express ourselves non-verbally, but also verbally even better. Ah, y'all can tell how much I go in the woods, right? These are pretty. All right, let me pick one. Let's see here. This is a random thought, but do you think that queer people are viewed like weeds? I mean, we aerate the soil, make the world grow. But at the same time, we're not necessarily always invited to the garden, right? I don't know.
Incredibly resilient, right?
Incredibly resilient. If I threw this thing back in there, it would sprout again. I'll just do that, actually.
Nature is queer. Like, nature is inherently queer. Like, nature is whatever it Ooh. Is that was before queerness.
That's a saying.
Was a word.
Nature is queer.
Nature is queer. It's a saying. Folks say it. People be saying that.
Now I'm going to say
mm-hmm.
it.
Nature is queer. Like, everything about it. There's like I said, we used the word expansive before. There's an expansive to it, expansiveness to nature that exists beyond and outside of binaries, right? And that like it's so beautiful that some plants have like quote unquote male parts and some have female parts and some have both, and those are called perfect plants, right? We have conditioned ourselves to believe that perfect straight rows and orderly number, all these things like this is what order looks like, mm-hmm. but like it's actually chaos, and what we think of as chaos is actually the natural order of things, mm-hmm. and so even that concept is inherently queer, like being out in nature and like all of these unseen things you've been speaking mm-hmm. to, these are all like beautiful, expansive things that exist beyond what we, the binary that we impose on it. And so I think queer people, right, which is acknowledged by indigenous culture across the globe, right? Like
across the globe,
First Nations people have like a more common terminology for it, like Two-Spirit, right? Mm-hmm. There are, and so people who are what we would call queer in most indigenous cultures across the world are people who are more connected to nature and therefore spirit. The one thing that came to my mind, it feels a little awkward to say, but I'm gonna say it anyway. And I'm gonna use ableist language, and I apologize in advance, and I feel comfortable using it only because I identify with the label that I'm using. But I used to think I was crazy. Like, I thought I was crazy. Like, I used to think that, like, I was an insane person. I used to think I was crazy. And then I just realized I wasn't white, you know? And I fully embraced that. I embraced that I didn't have to, like, keep trying to be white or pretending to be white or, you know what I mean? That I could just be who I was. I don't have to keep, like, trying to align with whiteness or trying to be white or white adjacent or whatever. I can just be who I actually am. And so what I offered my students was, like, that you can give yourself permission to let that go. Like, you don't have to, like, hold yourself to, like, white beauty standards. You don't have to hold yourself to white cultural norms. Like, white people don't have to hold themselves to that. Like, they can re-embrace who they are. Right? So we're already outside of that, like you're saying. And so the more that we try to be that, I think the crazier it makes us.
Don't wait for me, summer.